Good evening, all. Thank you all for registering for this event. I am Shahim Becker, and I am in charge of industry relations at IEEE Kerala section. From registrations, I see that around 45% of the participants are not members of IEEE. For their information, IEEE is an international body of professionals, the largest of its kind in the world. IEEE is responsible for formulating several standards in IT, electronics, and electrical domains. The tagline of IEEE is advancing technology for humanity, and we conduct thousands of technology conferences and events every year globally. And IEEE is having the largest database of technology publications. IEEE Kerala section is one of the most active sections globally with a number of global awards, including the best section awards won multiple times. As of date, Kerala section is the fourth largest in the world in terms of membership count. In 2019 alone, we conducted 500 plus events in Kerala alone. The current COVID situation and the lockdown, as we know, created an unprecedented economic slowdown globally. Most of the concerns being raised among the technology community are how technology jobs will be affected. Will it create more jobs in Kerala, since many Western nations will see Kerala as a pool of low cost and efficient workforce? Or will the global slowdown causes loss of jobs in Kerala too? Will more startups utilize this crisis as an opportunity? Is it the right time for Kerala to promote manufacturing? The questions goes on. Here we are blessed with a very eminent set of panelists who will be able to address these concerns. We have Mr. Afzal Salu, the CEO and co-founder of BestDoc Technology Private Limited. BestDoc is a health tech startup building next-gen intelligent patient relationship management platform for hospitals. Founded in 2018, they already have 100 plus hospitals in their pipeline. He is also the co-founder of Deliver.com, which got acquired by BigBasket.com. He has worked with Unilever prior to his startup. He is an alumnus of IIM Lucknow. Let me welcome Mr. Afzal to this discussion. Mr. Afzal, could you please turn on your camera and for a moment and just say hello? I request all other participants to turn off their videos and mute their mics.
Good evening, everyone. Afzal here. Thanks for the introduction, Shaheem.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Ms. Priya Balan, she is the head of HR at Terumo Penpal Private Limited, Thiruvananthapuram, which is a subsidiary of Terumo Corporation, Japan. It's a subsidiary of Terumo Corporation, Japan, and is Asia's largest blood bag manufacturer with customers in 80 countries. Penpal is having a 1,500 member data workforce. Ms. Priya has also worked with the IT industry. We are fortunate to have such an experienced HR professional in the panel. Madam, on behalf of IEEE, let me welcome you to the panel. I hope she will be coming back soon online.
Shaheem, hello.
We have.
I think she's back. She's back.
Okay. Ms. Priya Balan, we have just given your introduction. Could you please open up your cam and say just come on screen for a moment?
I think she hasn't got the audio connection properly.
Okay, let me go ahead with the introduction of the next speaker. We have announced that Mr. Shashi PM, the CEO of IT Parks of Kerala, will be joining us. But due to some personal emergency, he couldn't be part of the panel. But he has helped us in arranging a very eminent professional to the panel, Dr. Saji Gopinath, CEO of Kerala Startup Mission and the director of IIIT MK. Previously, he was the professor and dean at IIM, dean of business studies, Bennett University, director, TAPI Management Institute, Manipal. He has also worked with ONGC, L&T, and NIT Calicut. He is an alumnus of IISc. Let me welcome Dr. Saji Gopinath to this session.
Hey, good evening. See you all. Look forward to the discussion.
We are fortunate to have such a person who was instrumental in building a very positive startup ecosystem in Kerala with us today. Dr. Samir Assam, professor in electronics and head of training and placement cell of NIT Calicut. He is currently a member of the board of governors of APJ Abdul Kalam Technological University of Kerala. He has 75 plus published research papers to his credit and 2 US patents. An alumnus of TKMC Kollam and IIT Kharagpur. He was immediate past chair of IEEE Kerala and is currently the chair of strategic initiatives for academia engagement in Kerala section. Let us welcome Dr. Samir.
Hello, good evening to all the fellow panel members and the participants of this program. Look forward to exciting discussions.
Mr. Vijay Kumar, CEO and co-founder of INAP. INAP is a CMMI level 5 company with offices in USA, India, and Japan with a strong team of 250 plus engineers and with a big list of clients, including several Fortune 500 companies around the globe. Mr. Vijay was previously CEO of Best House and Kumar's. He has also He has also worked with Castrol. He is currently the chairman of CII Trivandrum Zone. He has served in the National Board of Roundtable India. Let us welcome Mr. Vijay.
Thank you, Shahim, and good evening to you all.
I think Ms. Priya has disconnected. She is calling me. Anyway, let me handle that after this introduction. Now to moderate this very eminent panel, we have another eminent personality who happens to be a very active IEEE leader too, Mr. Satish Babu. He is the co-founder and president of INAP and is the founding director of International Center of Force or the IC Force Kerala. Currently, he is the chair of APRALO ICANN, the international body in charge of internet governance globally. He is a past chair of IEEE Kerala section and past president of Computer Society of India. He is currently the chair of strategic initiative of industry engagement of IEEE Kerala section. Let me hand over to Sadhish sir to take this meeting forward.
Hi, and I hope you can hear me and see me as well. My name is Satish, and Shahim, thanks for the kind words of introduction. We have lined up a very eminent panel for all of you. I note that our audience is still gathering. We have about 50 people on the call right now, but we have many more who are registered, and hopefully they'll be joining us shortly. Let me introduce you to you the format of this this particular session. We are going to the theme of this particular session is post-COVID changes in the technology job market. I understand that many of you in the audience, in the among the participants, are students, but also there are a bunch of professionals as well. And I have to wish everybody good morning, good afternoon, good evening, because we have people from different time zones in the call. So welcome to everybody. As you can imagine, the COVID crisis has raised all kinds of questions at every level in society. Essentially, the professionals, the young professionals, the students, the retired people, you know, men, women, everybody has been confronted with a whole bunch of issues. Now, this session is largely to look at the employment, at the job market, and related issues. And we have a bunch of questions that you have proposed while registering for this. The underlying theme in many of these questions have to do with will there be a certain loss of volume of jobs, quality of jobs, remuneration, restructuring in the industry? What should I prepare myself with? What kind of skills should I now have post-COVID so that I'm able to secure a good job for myself? What is the kind of, we have manufacturing, we have the services sector. How are these sectors differentially impacted by the COVID crisis? And even the fundamental issues like, will I be able to get a job? The most fundamental thing for an aspirant who is just passing out now. The role of the government is another very important thing. And another aspect that gives us a lot of hope is the current startup ecosystem in Kerala, which is very dynamic. We will also listen to the Kerala Startup Mission CEO, as well as we would also like to hear from the industry or the trade bodies. And we also have a person who's that's Vijay, as already introduced by Shahim. So we have a very good panel lined up. So we would be starting off by giving 5 minutes to each panelist for making an opening statement from their perspective. After these 5 minutes are over for the five panelists, we will take up a few questions which are shortlisted, which are merged from the questions that you have provided us with in the registration. And then we will open up for questions in the from all of you dynamically. So for this, please type your questions into chat, and the moderators, the call managers will kind of read these questions out, and we will have the panel respond to these questions. We hope to be able to run this session until about 5:15, and then wind up by 5:20 or so. So that's the basic structure. Let me take the liberty of now inviting all the panelists, one after the other. To begin the list of panelists, we have Afzal Saloo. Please go ahead, Afzal.
Thank you, Mr. Satish, and a warm good evening to everyone. So first of all, let me thank IEEE for giving me an opportunity to be a part of such an eminent panel and share my insights on how it could be post-COVID. First of all, a brief intro. I run BestDoc, which is an health tech SaaS startup based out of Infopark in Cochin. We work with about 100 plus hospitals across. So naturally, we were one of the first to understand the impact of COVID while working with hospitals. In fact, about 50% of our employees work very closely with the hospital and do field operations. So we were able to understand the impact of COVID much before others while being in constant touch with the hospitals. Over the last 1 month, what we have seen is there has been a very good containment of the spread of this particular pandemic, particularly in Kerala and some of the other southern states. And we are also able to work with hospitals in moving most of their operations to digital. So first we moved the entire tech team to work from home, and we were able to support the hospitals in launching a teleconsultation product so that their doctors could continue working with the patients whom they were seeing before. So this was one good product which came out of this particular situation in terms of higher adoption of digital health. And we feel that healthcare would be the first sector to bounce back post-COVID. And we see more and more adoption of digital health products. In addition to that, Pure Play SaaS, we being in that particular space, was very useful for us to actually pitch to the hospitals even outside Kerala in terms of telling them that we would be able to help them optimize their cost as well as help them manage their patient experience better. So we foresee that the demand for higher adoption of digital health would be prevalent across the country. And we look at this as an opportunity to fine-tune our products as well as scale once we come out of this after a couple of quarters. Over to you, Mr. Satish.
Thanks for a very quick intervention. We will, of course, come back to you for further comments as we get started with the questions.
Sure.
It's over to Priya Balan, who's the HR head of Terumo Penpal. Priya, are you with us? Are you able to hear and see us?
Satish, I had a message from Priya that she's got some hardware problems and she's having issues with connecting. And the line is also kind of breaking on and off. So perhaps she's not online right now.
Right. Thanks, Vijay. So we will then move on and wait for Priya to join us after her problems are sorted out. We now move on to Dr. Sajid Gopinath, who wears the twin hats of Triple IT Director and Kerala Startup Mission CEO. Over to you, Dr. Sajid Gopinath.
Good evening, and thank you for inviting me to this panel, a very eminent panel, and very look forward to very exciting discussions. We know that we are at an interesting time, and we are looking forward to the next stage of growth. And I think that this is the right time for us to look at what type of skill sets are going to help us into the next wave. Now, one thing which we have seen, and I just put two or three points. One is we have seen that in this period, the way the startups across the world has actually responded to that and pivoted many of their products and the type of growth happened is actually very, very impressive. Just to give a very key example here is we are using a Zoom, for example. It's not by a very large company, even though we have other bigger platforms which are by bigger companies, but the way Zoom has actually becoming so popular with all other challenges it is, it actually shows how fast this startup ecosystem in the world is moving. And even in Kerala, we have seen companies who are responding to the challenges, responding to pivoting their product and making solutions. Now we have a set of startups along with a little larger company coming out with a solution to develop an N95 mask. Perhaps this may be the third company in the country who have the capability to make that. So what I mean to say is that this opportunity has given smaller companies to look at in a bigger way and start addressing that. And my feeling is that as we go forward, we are going to see this more. And with a lot of students attending this, this is going to be the in thing for us. Because we know that there is a shift from agriculture to industry to service. Next level will be going to be the smaller companies. Why do I think so? Because A, even when the economy is moving up and when you are seeing that post-COVID period, what is going to happen, at least for a limited period of time at least, is that there is going to be limited movement of people. Maybe goods will move, but people movement across nations, across states is going to become a challenge. So you are going to create economy within your own places. But then today with technology, we are actually able to address the needs of another part of the world. So you are going to come out with a solution where you may be physically located in one place, but you are going to address the challenges of another place as such. And I think that is basically going to be the big advantage for us going forward, provided we have the right skill sets for that. Many of you are aware of gig economy. And when you think about gig economy, we only think about Uber and Airbnb and things like that. But gig is not about that. They are only a platform. The gig is about how do I get a job on, or I do a part of a job on my own, and then maybe I'm paid for that. So from a conventional way of looking at a job as a permanent and a long-term and permanent employment, we move to a gig model as such. My feeling is that the COVID is actually going to make gig economy coming very fast for us. There may be platforms which helps us on that, but more importantly, for a state like Kerala, where a large number of qualified women professionals are there, and many of them are actually many times not have challenges of moving out, you are going to have a big opportunity. And the work from home, which has happened in the last few months, the companies have started realizing that, yes, work from home is a good option, and you can actually start looking at looking at resources across the world and work from home. When you're working from home, whether you're working in an American company, whether you're working in a company in Bangalore, or whether you're working in a company in Cochin, does not make any difference. Your home can be anywhere. So this is going to be a big change which is going to happen. And some sectors, which is conventionally very physical, also may going to be disrupted and with the technology process. So to put the points in brief, there is obviously changes in the jobs. The conventional jobs may change to a substantial extent, but there is a set of new jobs are going to come, and people who are qualified and skilled are going to have a next level of growth which is going to happen. I believe there are a lot of teachers here, and many of them can actually look at this as a great opportunity, because this is an opportunity where you can actually reskill your students and enable this gig economy, which can actually make Kerala into the next level and actually result in a much less job loss per se. That's my thought.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sajid Gopinath. So combining what Dr. Sajid Gopinath mentioned and what Afsal mentioned, it's very clear that there is going to be a transformation of jobs and work from home, which is actually work from anywhere. When you combine with the numbers of some of the sections of society like women that we have in Kerala, actually can be leveraged in various creative ways as we go forward. We now would like to hear from Dr. Samir, who is going to give us a perspective from the academic side of things. Over to you, Samir.
Good evening, Satish, and good evening to the participants. Hope I'm audible. And
yes.
Yeah. So now we have a very kind of tricky situation before us as far as the students who are passing out from various engineering colleges this year, 2020, across the country, and Kerala in particular. From we have about 140 plus engineering colleges, and about 35,000 students are expected to complete the course by July, August, maybe a little later. And as head of training and placement at NIT Calicut, I have conducted campus recruitment of about 140 companies in the campus. I'm very sure that the NIT perspectives or IIT perspectives are different as compared to other colleges, but still we will have some generic lessons from all these. And everyone is basically afraid, all students across the country are basically afraid that the job offers that they have received is at stake, and sometimes you may lose it, and there is no other alternative and all. So I happen to contact most of our recruiters or email and or phone, and almost all of them, except just one company, all of them have assured that all the job offers that they have extended to the students will be honored, and there is no need to be panic. Only thing is, there are uncertainties on the course completion dates of various universities, so the joining date would be delayed, and there is of course uncertainty over the new projects, the economic scenario and all, which will be affecting some of the companies at a little later stage, and the correspondingly the joining dates of many companies, especially the companies in the core sectors, which are going to be which are likely to be affected more, would be delayed maybe by 3 months or 6 months. So, but moving ahead, we also need to see that looking at the Kerala population, like we have about 35,000 students. Out of that, maybe 6,000 or 7,000 students will be having a campus offer with them, and the remaining students have to find offers from the job market now in the next a few months. They will be actively trying for opportunities. So so this situation is going to affect their prospects in some way, and then more importantly, the students who are likely to graduate in 2021 who would be getting campus placement opportunities from various companies in the coming academic year will also be affected to a certain extent, because the next batches are likely to affect more, because companies will have more idea about their future plans by the time they go for next recruitment. And while they will be reluctant to, decline the offers already extended to the students, but they may reduce their hiring plans for the next cycle, perhaps. So therefore, it is very important for the students to, look at the available opportunities very seriously. So what are the available opportunities for the students? So generally, the first thing that the students will look for is to get a job from the campus itself, right? And maybe try something outside the campus if they are unable to get a campus. The second is to go for higher studies, basically. And maybe in a situation like this, higher studies may help to a great extent, because if they get into a master's program, another 2 years, they'll be in campus. And by the time they come out, the situation may likely to improve, and they will be able to get good offers. And the third, obviously, is explore the possibility of, starting something on their own, maybe in a slow pace in different sectors. And I'll start with the last one. So the last point is very interesting, because in the COVID-related technology challenges itself, we have seen in the newspapers and WhatsApp and other media that students from various engineering colleges have come out with very good and interesting alternatives for portable ventilators and all. In a very short time, there could be a lot of technical lacunas, but then people came up with a lot of ideas, and therefore students have the potential to look into the available opportunities in the market and then come out with new technological solutions. So this is one, as Sajid Gopinath mentioned, this is one serious area where students can group themselves and then explore the technological challenges that COVID has brought to us, and then try to attack the solutions. And probably, the girls also will be able to be a great part of this job, because they want to explore a lot of challenges coming up from the markets outside Kerala. And looking at the first aspect, like getting a campus placement offer, obviously will become more important and more challenging in the coming times. Students need to upskill their skills. There was a question like whether a jack of all or master of one should be more ideal in the new scenarios. What I feel is that students should focus on mastering the required skill set, not like just any generic skill set will help them. They have to look at polishing their skill set by multiple means, by looking at new subject areas and courses in the cutting edge areas like artificial intelligence or machine learning, robotics, cybersecurity, data analytics, blockchain, etc., which are the new buzzwords. Though the industry 4.0 will take a little more time perhaps to come into the workplace in the current scenario, but these skill sets will definitely help them to grab some better opportunities from this market. But it is not just doing a course will help, but then they have to have some hands-on experience of doing a project, a serious project related to a practical relevant problem would really helpful for the students to upgrade their skill set. So this is one thing and then obviously their communication skills and all other presentation skills, etc., are to be improved, because when the number of offers are less and aspirants are more, definitely companies will be very choosy, and therefore it is very important to have the right attitude and right skill set for the students. One last word to the academicians attending this panel. Actually, our job is very challenging in the coming times, and unless we train our students to equip these additional skill set and challenges in the market scenario, our students will be finding it difficult to get opportunities. So therefore, it is very important for the academicians to understand the changes happening in the industry. So for that, there will be a lot of players coming into market in the near future, giving a lot of paid training kind of thing, and which is a phenomena that we see these days. So we have to keep away from all these, but then get connected to the alumni of your colleges and people, your friends and all working in the industry, and ask them to come to the campuses through these virtual platforms and all, connect with the students and convey what is going on in the industry and what are the new skill set used by the industry, required by the industry, and then encourage your students to acquire these skill set firstly, as part of your own courses, basically give micro projects as part of the course and then ask students to get hands-on experience in different new technologies, and also take ask the students to take the major projects and other minor projects as serious matters. They should not just outsource the work and get it done by others, but they have to, I mean, do take these things seriously and polish their skill set. So times are very challenging, but I feel that if the students are having the right skill set, they would be able to still capitalize a lot of opportunities which are coming in multitude of ways. Thank you, Sandesh.
Thanks very much, Samir, for that very insightful presentation. We all kind of completely agree that the students also have to kind of reinvent themselves in terms of skill sets. And I think organizations like IEEE have a role in informing students and teachers, especially, about the changes that are happening, which are unfolding in front of our eyes in different parts of the world. And it's also interesting to note that COVID itself has become a source of a number of projects by students, and some of these may move on to being startups and so on. Before I move to Vijay, I'd like to check if Priya has joined by phone. Priya, are you able to hear us?
Yes, Satish. Great. Can you all hear me? Because handset and I'm not able to come on video. Because
no problem. We can hear you very well.
The rains, the network is creating some issues. So I thought I'll join on. You know. That's how technology is.
Great. So you're great that you could join. So yeah, technology is, we have all these glitches that you're used to.
Exactly.
Now. Yeah, please go ahead with your presentation.
Yes. Good evening, all. And first of all, let me thank IEEE for giving this opportunity and inviting me to be the panelist with the eminent panelist team already. So I work for a company called Termo Penpol, which is completely out of your IT segment. It's a manufacturing unit. So this company, to just give a background of the company, yes, we are the subsidiary of the Giant Thermo Corporation of Japan. So what we do is we manufacture blood bags, so which is in a larger capacity, and we are right now Asia's largest blood bag manufacturers. So right now we export to 80 countries, and we have almost 1,500 employees working with us in the plant. So this is in a nutshell about our company, and the plant is 35 years old as on date. This is a bit of background about my company. And so I head the HR function of this company for the last 11 years. So yes, so before moving on to the conversation directly into the topic, in my perspective, most of the discussions right now we are having about the pandemic, it treats it as one more disruption in the list of several things that preceded it. So, but that view to me accordingly is a mistake and misleading, because it prevents us from seeing the differences with the earlier events. So when we look at it this way, after the second, maybe post World War II, we have never come across such an event which has, you know, massive impact on people and the economic activities. So this is one such, a very serious event, COVID-19. So the effects, basically, when you see it, it's wide ranging, starting from, you know, the social behavior of people to the shopping habits, and also to, you know, making people work from home. So that's a huge transformation. So the very concept of work itself is getting, undergoing a profound changes gradually. So work, when we talk about work, we always have a systematic plan and a kind of organized work culture. That has now been shifted into a completely different scenario. So as I come from a manufacturing segment, which as we always see in manufacturing, working from home is something we see that as a jargon that cannot be used in the manufacturing sector. This is what was going on until, say, 42 days back. So it's like, until then, we thought it is only meant for, you know, IT sector, and maybe we will not be able to accommodate this in our system. So how did this COVID impact on our business and the work culture? So first, to give a little bit about the business background, I would say, when the impact of this pandemic started, what first comes into our mind is the lockdown. So what happens when the lockdown comes in. Yes, the first thing that hits our kind of environment, work environment, is the supply chain gets affected. What happens when the supply chain gets affected? Your raw materials cannot be shipped into the factory. So no raw materials, so you will not be able to produce your product. So the question may be, okay, every day we are not going to buy product and make, you know, product. But however, so even if you have your inventory left and you start manufacturing, shipping out the product, it becomes a problem because again, your logistics gets affected. So there is a minimal capacity that you can hold your inventory. So you cannot produce all the raw material into your product, and then the shipment is not happening. Again, it's going to stay in your factory, which is not possible. So this is how it has a huge impact on the manufacturing segment in terms of business. So in terms of work, how does it affect? Yes, in manufacturing segment, when you need to work with a plant, yes, you need to be physically present over there. So otherwise, it doesn't just happen. You cannot sit elsewhere and then, you know, operate your plant. So that's two sides to it. But how do we manage? And among all this, yes, you have your social distancing. Even if you start running your plant, you need to maintain 1 meter distance. Everything becomes a problem. So a large amount of thought needs to be going in, you know, when you really run a plant and how we manage about it. So overall, what I'm trying to say is when you have to bring in systems in place, how you manage your shift. You have 3 shifts running in the plant. So you'll have to curtail into 1 shift and see how it works. Maybe the production amount may be lesser. So these are all some of the thoughts that has been going around in us. And gradually we had come across the lockdown. We had to shut down our plant for some days. And now we have, just reopened and gradually adding people to it and managing it. So overall, that is the work from home culture across the organization. Why not we support? Okay, let us minimize the strength in the plant. And why not we start thinking about giving people a flexible working environment? So that seemed to be helping us. That's the only thing that we possibly put it across to the government, and we managed to open our plant. In spite of we having the medical devices and the life-saving product is what we're manufacturing. So overall, what I'm trying to say is this will confer the flexibility and many more options on recruiters who are going to have greater room to find suitable and proper resources. So COVID-19 disruption in total has brought into a sharp focus on the wastefulness of most people movement on work. This is what we are trying to And look at, we are going to eliminate any process that is not going to add value when people are going to sit over there, or we'll try to, you know, take maximum advantage out of them, or the efficiency can be utilized keeping them work remotely. So this is one thing we have very strongly in our area we have put in place, in our manufacturing segment we have put in place. So as I said, many companies still trying to, you know, figure out how to bridge this gap and come out of this. So those companies, as I say, always say that embrace change fast will go far ahead, while others will be forced to follow later. So this is the central point that I wish to make. And coming to the youngsters in 2020, there were some questions around, will it be difficult in 2020 passouts to get a job? Yes, handing out your CV is not going to help. So what the expectation as a HR or as an organization, it would be, you'll have to put more stress on your extracurricular abilities and activities. When I say extracurricular ability and activity, it's not just, you know, I'm good at this and good at kind of in this game and not that. Put yourself a little thought and put yourself thinking that, yes, how flexible you can be, how adaptable you can be. So these are all some of the, you know, so how creative you can be. These are all some of the things that is going to have more impact on your CVs going forward. Rather than just putting your the discipline that you have studied, add so many things like this into your CV, saying how creative, how flexible, how adaptable you can be. So that's going to kind of attract the recruiters or the companies moving forward. So this is one. Second, I would say, how do I need to, you know, prepare students to go to COVID-19 changes in the industry? So while I would say the core subjects in each discipline must be learned, it is equally also important to know a little in related areas, like multidisciplinary studies is something that's going to attract more traction in future. So rather than when you come as an electronic engineer, try to just have spread your thoughts and mind a little bit around the other area, and try to be sure that at least you are willing to learn something beyond your discipline, and that gives a confidence that company, that is what the companies are going to look forward to. That's the kind of people basically they will want to hire. So the third one, one of the questions I saw was what preparations need to be done on the part of the fresher graduating. So target companies to search for jobs and see how you can be of use to them. So standard job description templates are going to change. This COVID has created that kind of an image that what a person, when he comes in, they do not want a person to be very rigid and to have a perception that I'm this kind of an engineer, I'm going to do only this particular job. That has to be changed. So these are some of the thoughts that that has come in my mind over the course of discussion. Yes, I'll be able to handle more questions related to this. So over to Satish.
Thanks very much, Priya, for your very insightful comments. It is indeed interesting that companies are going to be more choosy about who they recruit. So it's up to the job aspirants to present themselves as Priya mentioned, being flexible, being broader in our outlook, being interdisciplinary. In fact, if you have taken up a post-COVID project of some kind, that itself is, I think, combination of all these things that we just mentioned. That gives a certain perspective over and beyond the academic discipline that you're studying. You know, that may help to kind of land jobs. We now have Vijay, who's wearing the twin hats of the CEO of an IT company and the CII's Trivandrum representative. Over to you, Vijay, for your thoughts.
Thank you, Satish. Good evening, all. I'm Vijay. I work with InApp, which is a company with offices here in Technopark and one in Bangalore, and also in the US and Japan. Let me first acknowledge and thank IEEE, because a good large pool of very smart, intelligent talent that we get in every year happens to be people from the IEEE student community. It's also a matter of great pride for all of us that the fourth largest section in the world is in Kerala. So congratulations to IEEE. Let me first start by sharing a little bit of an industry perspective, go down to a little bit on Kerala IT, and then perhaps share some insights about my company itself to get a feel and flavor for what ground realities are in a practical sense. And I'll also probably touch upon a little bit on what Dr. Sameer talked about with regard to impact of jobs and as well as, what really is the requirement from a skilling and preparedness perspective. There has been a little optimistic view that has been kind of shared all through these earlier presentations. But I might take a view which is a little realistic and a little bit more about not being in denial. And there certainly is beyond doubt a very, very difficult situation that is being faced. If you look at the industry today, we across the nation, we are expecting a top line drop, a revenue drop of about 10%, and a bottom line drop of about 5% in this quarter. And these are figures which were published by CII, which was early this month. And this is a dynamically changing situation, which is actually getting worse as time progresses. So it's certainly a very, very significant dip on business. As Priya had mentioned, the lack of access to manpower and the challenges of moving products are certainly currently crippling the IT industry, and normalizing this is surely going to take some time. A casualty to this is certainly going to be job loss. And in an interview and a survey that's been done, about 52% of CEOs who were asked had actually come out saying that there will be a job loss to the tune of 15 to 30%. This again is early April, and it's possible things could have probably gone southwards. CII has given a lot of recommendations to government, but that's a completely different topic which I will not venture into now. Regarding Kerala, we did make a lot of representations again to the Chief Minister from 14, 15 different industries. But let me speak for want of time. Let me speak more about the IT industry itself, which is in Kerala. It's close to about $2 billion in outsourcing and has about 1.25 lakh of people. And this is not including the startups. So including that, it would be more. But if one were to, so we did a study, GTEC, which is a consortium of IT companies in the state, along with NASSCOM and CII, had done a study and come out with a finding that, again, these are, of course, crystal gazing because we don't really know. But what we did is we looked at large companies and what is the experience of large companies currently, what is the projection for the next quarter and the next one, and for mid and small companies. And these figures, interestingly, were different. But in summary, what we came up with is that potentially by the end of the year, we could be looking at a dip in revenue of about 600 million, which is about 45,000 crores, and loss of job, which is about 26,000 jobs. Now, I really think that is fairly exaggerated. I don't think this is going to be reality, but clearly there are indicators that there is going to be a very, very significant impact and there's no running away from it. And all these numbers that I talked about in IT would also have manifest itself in other indirect jobs being lost, such as for transportation, even for supporting this industry, cleaning, security, and so on. And that is estimated to be far higher and to a tune of about 80,000. So there is significantly a job loss that is likely to be in the horizon if we are seeing the kind of dip in revenue and business that the industry currently witnesses. Now, let me come to very specifically about our own company, InApp, and what we have been seeing. True enough, we have also seen some dip in business. We have had customers who have completely pulled off. Fortunately, they have not been critical customers, so we have not been impacted too hugely, but beyond doubt, we have been impacted. In many cases, we have actually kind of gone back to the customer offering a three-month significant discounting in terms of the rates that we offer. But there have also been, it must be said, that there have been instances. And in fact, this morning I was on a call with a company which is based out of Hong Kong and having an office in Vancouver. They're looking at offshoring and using talent from India. And they want to develop a kind of a cutting edge platform for e-learning, which again, at this point of time is probably very relevant. There's another customer of ours in Ohio, which supplies food to the poor. This has got nothing to do with COVID, but that is the business they were into. And that has become far more relevant today. And therefore, there's an urgency for their operations and thereby a lot more of IT support that is needed. So business is going up with that particular customer. There is, interestingly, a customer in the construction industry. And the construction industry is not doing brilliantly. But this particular customer happens to have deep pockets. And what they are trying to do is to kind of be ahead of their competition at the time when things pick up. So they are now investing. And fortunately, they can invest in kind of going to far more improved kind of systems. The reason I say that is that it is not complete doomsday. It's not as if things have completely kind of crumbled down. There are opportunities and many of them are certainly there as well. Let me just quickly touch upon the impact of jobs. I won't dwell into it too much now, and we could probably go into it in more detail because it's already been touched upon, particularly by Priya. But it certainly is going to be there. But is it going to be a situation that is devastating? Perhaps not. It only means that the number of jobs available are much lesser, and therefore the competition for them is much higher, and therefore the ability to present yourself and equip yourself with the necessary skills in order to be able to kind of land yourself a job is significantly higher than it would have been at a point in time when the demand was extremely, extremely high. A word about working from home, and this is something which is intriguing me because it's always been something that a model which has been extremely effective in the Western world, but many of us felt that this is not something that will work effectively, but COVID has proved it wrong. The productivity, interestingly, in work from home models is extremely high. I did read about TCS, and there are some companies that are talking about even post-COVID, they probably encourage work from home. And this perhaps might be also a significant incentive by way of cost reduction. Hard to say how things will unfold, but my own personal opinion is that work from home will happen. It will happen to the extent of people who desire to work from home for certain compulsions. For example, I'm based in Trivandrum. I'm moving to Bangalore. I would like to retain my job. Well, you can, because we know how to work with you if you're in Bangalore. As Sajid had mentioned, we are not constrained to look at people from Trivandrum. We can start looking at people from any geography right now. But even that being said, I do believe that there will be some inherent restriction to work from home, more from a social context. If you look at the youngsters who join the workforce, they are people who are, we're all social creatures. Employee engagement, keeping them happy, for them to kind of get together in the cafeteria, have fun together, is very, very, very important. So therefore, by choice, I would presume that there may be a very high percentage of people who opt to actually continue to work from an office rather than work from home. But that being said, this is again something which Sajji mentioned, which is part of the gig economy and what it means. As we progress, it is most likely, and more likely than not, that you would really see individuals, not necessarily associated with a particular company, but working with global teams and as complete freelancers. So the advantage here for the company would be that it would be very cost effective, it can be flexible, people are very responsive, they'll be completely invested into the company. And for the individual also, there certainly is a benefit that, you know, one, you're earning in dollars, so potentially much better returns, the flexibility of choosing the project that you like, the flexibility of the working the hours that you like, and so on and so forth, much higher exposures. Disadvantage clearly is that the job security that you have today is perhaps going to be in same measure, and therefore it's not very steady. But again, if competence is of high order, that's not something that would ever be an issue. Now, in order to equip yourself for this freelance gig economy, one would really need to kind of work hard to create an online portfolio, which basically you need to market yourself. There's a bit of what I would want to talk about that, if that's of interest to anybody, in terms of how do you equip yourself? How do you kind of show to the world that you're a very, very competent person? What are some of the things that you would need to do for that? And if that's of interest, I'm happy to kind of dig a little deeper into that in the Q&A if required. Very briefly, for the fresh batches, there are jobs, there would be a lot of requirements. I'm glad that the finding from Dr. Samir, when he spoke to many people, many companies, is that they're all going to honor the kind of commitments they made. That's also the sense that I get talking to companies in the industry. But necessarily you'll need to do a lot more skilling up. The job market is going to shrink, perhaps. The walk-ins are not going to be like they used to be. But at the same time, very, very importantly, INAP has been through two recessions in the past, and this is important. I would like each of you to kind of recognize this very clearly. We have been through two recessions in the past, and we have gone through a cycle where the smartest of people did find challenges in getting jobs. There were the IITians who didn't have a job. But there did come a time, not much later, when they did eventually, the things did change, things did move on, and 10 years down the line, they are now in very leading senior positions in companies. So do remember that this is something which is transitional. This will pass. And we do the best we can, but don't lose heart and keep tugging at it. So that's, I think, what I will stop for now, Satish, if that's okay. But I can come back again in Q&A. I also have some thoughts for Dr. Samir, but I think my time is up, so I'll stop for now.
Thanks, Vijay. We will, of course, come back to you based on how the Q&A goes. So I think Vijay has pointed out some of the possible issues, at least in the short term, that may include job losses, business losses, and even perhaps solvency issues for some companies, including maybe some startups, early startups particularly. Now, one of the aspects we have not touched here is what kind of a support can we get if this is the case? Now, I think there is general consensus that this is not going to be, while COVID will take some time to resolve, maybe several months, maybe the whole of this year, maybe a little bit into the next year as well. But these job losses may not be a long-term problem. It will resolve itself in maybe a year's time latest. But in the meantime, the companies, the job aspirants, startups, they all have to survive. So, Is it a government's kind of job to help us in this juncture? What can companies do? So this is one bunch of questions that we might want to discuss. But before we get into that, I'd like to request people who want to ask questions to please type your questions into the chat so that the moderators can look at the questions and read them out. But in the meantime, I would like to raise this one question to all the panelists. I request for very short responses, 1 minute each, on if there are going to be this kind of losses, job losses and business losses in the short term, maybe for the rest of 2020, is there something that you think that we can do as the industry or the government can do to mitigate the effects of these losses? So I'll quickly run through all the panelists one after the other for a minute. Afzal, do you have any thoughts on this?
Yes. So with respect to the next three quarters, I would say there would be subdued demand. And hence, most of the sectors, including IT, also would go through a pause in terms of job, new job creation as well as recruitment. So there would be reskilling which would be required. And hence, it would be also important for the new job aspirants to identify sectors which would pick up during this period as well as post. For example, digital economy, be it fintech, online education, content, all of this are continuing to have good demand. And those would be the sectors where there would be increased demand post-COVID as well, particularly because most of the businesses also will look at how to actually reach out to consumers digitally. Digital marketing, all those opportunities would actually pick up. Hence, with respect to identifying which are the roles to be filled in or reskilled, it would be all having digital edge. Hence, most of the new jobs would have a clear definition of how digitally enabled the candidate is in terms of being able to work from home as well as being able to serve a digital economy. Integrations, API, those are the skill sets which would be very relevant in the future world. And hence, we are also looking at making sure our team is moving towards that kind of skill sets.
Thanks very much, Afzal. Over to you, Priya, for your brief thoughts on this issue. Priya, can you hear us? There seems to be some problem with Priya's audio. So we will move on to Dr. Saji Gopinath. Dr. Gopinath, do you think these losses, scenario of job losses is correct? And how do you think we can mitigate this?
Hello.
Yes. Hello. I believe, I think I tend to agree with what Afzal said. There will be subdued demand in most of the sectors, except some of the sectors have got the sudden increase in demand also. So what I think a government should do, and maybe this is what happened in the last pandemic also, is that there is going to be a substantial amount of fiscal investment which happens after or maybe at the last stage of COVID. So till that point of time, the governments across the world is trying to ensure that some of the fixed costs which is there with the companies are getting reduced. Maybe in our context, it's also important for the companies to ensure that they stay afloat, because I'll just, if you allow me, I'll just share a screen just to give you just to prove a point. This is actually the economic growth between 1900 to 1940. And you can see the first blue block which I've shown is a time where our biggest pandemic, Spanish flu, happened at that point of time. And there was an economic dip, exactly like what happened. But what happened immediately after that is a fast growth. So the challenge today is, how do we actually ensure that we remain afloat till that point of time? That's basically where the focus today. And also to ensure that the moment you move into the next stage, you have the right skill set to move. So this is a role where all of us have to play. The industry has to play a role to see how we can cut down our non-value adding expenses. There are some of the costs which has already come down, but further we need to be able to look at it, not necessarily manpower, but many other costs can be reduced. The second, government can look at some of the support measures. Banks can look at how do we actually increase the liquidity in the system. If you have all these measures and if you keep thing afloat, then we will be ready for the next stage of growth. And that's what always we have seen in the case of these sort of the externally forced economic recession. It's not a result of an individual or a country or an organization. It's an externally forced recession. So naturally, you will have your response to that is very different from something which happened because some banks have done some fraud or things like that. So this being the case, I believe that if you can actually keep afloat, then there is a growth which is going to happen.
Thanks very much, Dr. Gopinath. So there is light at the end of the tunnel after all. I think I heard Priya come in.
Yes.
Please go ahead. Very short.
Yes, I mean, there will be issues in the next few quarters, but as Vijay rightly said, this is not a permanent, thing that's going to continue forever. This is just a passing phase. So now it's COVID and it's going to be another for the next 3-4 quarters, it's going to be difficult. The job market definitely is going to be difficult. But later on, it's going to catch up back into action. And I mean, do we really think or do we really want this to continue forever? No. So right now, yes, there are overstaffing. When we from HR perspective, when we look at it, right now, what is it we are looking at? We want to reduce cost. This is something that goes into any business mind. So we look at if we are overstaffed in our companies, we go into that check and try to cut down responsibility or reallocate or do a kind of job rotation. These are all the things that next few months it's going to be happening. And many of the recruitments are as of now to say in our company it has been put on hold. All the recruitments are right now were freezed. So no additional headcounts at this point in time. Everything has been pushed for the next 2 quarters, no recruitments. So the reason why is because we do not know where we are going ahead with this kind of conditions. Every day by day, when we look at the demographics, it's just going up and up every day. So it's like the pandemic numbers. So it's like we have to wait and watch. So at this point in time, it's going to be difficult, but this is definitely going to come back to normalcy in next after 3 quarters or so. So how do we see this? Yes. First thing is like most of the companies, they will try to reduce cost in whatever possible way. So overstaffing is one way to look at it. Many service sector jobs also will change in character, will need to be done remotely or differently. So more jobs naturally will become kind of jig type jobs. It's kind of contracts and it will go. So most of the time, each person should be, what I would rather suggest is, as I said earlier, each person should be willing to do anything she or he can possibly can. And that is what is needed in a gig economy, where quality and the proactive attitude is what matters a lot. So in manufacturing, there will be a delay, but it will take at least 3 quarters to stay out. And later on, it's going to definitely come back to, the graph will go up and naturally, the recruitments, and slowly, gradually, we will try to be recruiting new people as well. Yes.
Thanks very much, Priya. You were basically saying that companies will be kind of examining or introspecting themselves and seeing how they can cut flab and increase efficiency and so on.
Exactly.
Thanks. Over to you, Samir, for a 1-minute intervention on this question.
Thank you, Sadish. Actually, the academic institution perspective, I see a lot of potential for adopting new technologies. Actually, there was a question also posed to me in that particular direction. So let me tell you a couple of things. The first thing is that the students who are coming out from colleges this year, and they will have a tough time, obviously. And I think the university, the Kerala Technological University, and other mechanisms need to bring in experts from various industries at one forum, either virtual platforms or so, from different sectors, and try to understand what are the plans of these industries focus areas of these industries in the short term, medium term, and long term. So academic institutions are very, very sluggish to adopt to changes. And therefore, it will take some time for the academic system to respond. But the products of the system, the students need to respond to changes quickly. So therefore, if the plans of the industries are really known to the students, what are the things in pipeline in the short term and long term? I know it is too early to predict things at this point of time, but still, if there are predictions and plans, then and that is revealed to the students through the right forums, then students will be able to equip themselves to polish their skills and upgrade their skills. So one additional point of opportunity which I would like to highlight is that many universities, including my colleges, faculty members across the country and across the world perhaps, are now adopting new technologies for teaching and evaluations. And though there has been a lot of technologies around, a lot of platforms around NPTEL, Coursera, and various other things, the, most of the faculty members were reluctant to use online tools for their teaching and evaluations. So now we are forced to do these kind of things for our curriculum, our courses, respective courses to complete and they complete the curriculum delivery and conduct the evaluation. Now we see real challenges. We have tools like Google Classrooms or Moodle or things like that. But still, when we try to use them, we see there are a lot of limitations. So there is tremendous opportunities for new startups and all and students to come up with platforms like, say, for example, Zoom, which is very easy to use for online education and especially evaluation, where we really find a lot of challenges. How to do, evaluations which is foolproof. So therefore, we see a lot of potential in these, and I strongly feel that many universities will continue to adopt online education and online evaluation as a mode, as a serious active mode for quite some time. I mean, it may flourish in the years to come. That's what I feel. So therefore, there are a lot of potentials in that area. Thank you.
Thanks, Samir. Now, before I go to Vijay, I note that there are several questions in the chat, and we have about 10 minutes that we can use up for responding to these questions. So I request the panelists to please take a look at the questions raised in the chat, just to save time, because if you start reading out the entire thing, it will take us some time. So after Vijay finishes his response, we will do one more round with all the panelists. And if you could please address one or two questions that are posed in the chat in the final round, it would, otherwise we don't have time to answer every question. So I will now request Vijay to speak to us on the issue of what can the government, what can the trade associations, what can the industry do to sustain itself for this few months ahead, first till we stabilize and start growing again.
Thank you, Satish. I must first say that our experience with the kind of proactiveness which the government, and I'm talking of our local Kerala government, has shown in many situations has been exemplary, absolutely exemplary. So we have passed on a lot of support requirements, of course, again, short-term requirements, where we have found that if it's operational in nature, it's almost immediately done. If it is something which is having a financial implication, then that kind of holds on. And it's not something which happens quick for obvious reasons. I think here we should recognize the fact that it is not as though the government has very rich coffers, but the industry, what it needs, as Dr. Sanjeev Gopinath mentioned, it needs to stay afloat. It needs to kind of maintain its operations until such time this whole issue kind of tides over. And that is the whole critical thing. So the support that is needed from the government, and we have made representations, and again, I'm referring very specifically to IT sector. Just to give a few examples of representations that we have given for way of support, we've asked for rental waivers, which is financial, for the 6 months. Can you please waive your rent so that our cash flows are better off? Government has, can they help with supporting with financial institutions like KCIBC, KSFE, etc., so that some kind of working capital support can be provided? Can government relax the normal norms when kind of looking at companies so that even smaller companies can participate in some of the kind of works that the government has so that they can do some work and make some revenues from it? Then other things like expediting, you know, GST returns, so on. There's also a lot of money that is currently pending, and many people have been working. We're asking, you know, can the money be made available quickly? So it's a lot of them are in the whole financial space. But we've also been requesting government for support from having a very empathetic labor department. It must be recognized that companies are also going through a very, very difficult time emotionally and from business standpoint as well. And to have somebody who goes by the rule book and starts to kind of make life very difficult for people who are having to take difficult decisions and circumstances should be something which is dealt with you know, kids gloves. And that's another request that they made. Another reason why I think we should applaud the Kerala government is that as soon as this whole issue started, at least the IT industry was fortunate that the capability to work from home was there, but the support extended by ensuring that the conversations happened with the ISPs to ensure that good bandwidth is there. The support by making sure that the electricity you know, is provided in the homes and there's no kind of disruption. Those are all things which I think greatly helped us. Tall and short, I think the government has been doing what they can. We need to recognize that they have very stringent limitations. And within that, ultimately, it ends up to the businesses to be able to kind of find out their ground for themselves and find out where their businesses come from and then pull through this phase and then and look at better times.
Thanks, Vijay. Satish. So now we go to the final round for the panelists. So I hope you have taken a look at some of the questions. For Priya, since you can't see the screen, I'd read out one question that might apply to you. The question says, and I quote, "It looks very likely that there will be restrictions in the interstate and foreign movements for some time. Will this lead to an increased local manufacturing and a greater shift towards hyper-local business?" So we will go by the same order, in the same order. Over to you, Afzal. Now keep yourself at about 1 to 1.5 minutes at most. Please go ahead.
Sure. So I would like to take up the question on whether IT companies and particularly in startups, what they should be focusing on. So the primary objective of any business is to generate profits and decent profits. And for that, they would have to look at revenues first or otherwise funding. So in this current scenario, when the funding is going to be tougher, the startups need to actually look at generating revenue or cash so that they're able to maintain the cash flow. And hence, it'd be important for early stage or revenue generating startups to look at optimizing their cost as well as generating more revenue out of the existing customers. SaaS economy is going to boom, and definitely that's one area where most of the IT companies need to focus on, whether they were in the services or in the product space. Now they would need to have a combination of software as a service getting out so that they're able to deploy it on the cloud, reach out to their clients much beyond their geography, and as well as generate additional revenues to maintain the cash flow.
Balasan.
Thanks very much, Afzal. Priya, it's over to you. Priya, are you able to hear us? I think there's a glitch with the audio again. So we will come back to Priya after this round is over. Over to you, Dr. Sajid Gopinath.
I'll take the question on the last question. I think the question was on whether this is going to lead to the self-sufficiency because since now we find that there are challenges. But it is not possible at this point of time for us to get into self-sufficiency in every sector, because we still have challenges. No, we still have to depend upon China in many things. Even in the context of electronics, you still don't have a strong fab ecosystem here.
you need to have components coming from another part of the world. But there will be definitely going to be a shift which is going to happen, and some of those areas which are going to grow, you can see more hyperlocal or local production going to happen. And the Make in India movement, I believe, is going to take a major change. But this all depends upon how we are going to manage this pandemic. So far, India has managed well. And it is said that businesses will flow to places where it has been battered less. So India, as of now, is not much battered. So if we can actually manage this without much of problems like what's happened in the West or in other parts of the world, then there is going to be a good boost for the Make in India movement. And that can actually create new sets of jobs.
Thanks very much, Dr. Sajid Gopinath. We now move on to Dr. Samir.
Yeah, Sadish, I will take up the question on adoption of digital learning. Basically, there was a question from Vijay. And the point is that I have recently attended, yesterday I concluded a course on innovations in digital learning. It's an online course from IIT Bombay. And about 2,200 faculty members across India has participated in that online course. So this indicates that there is a greater interest among faculty members for teaching contents through online means. Earlier in the traditional academic system, only 5 to 10% of faculty were using learning methodologies other than Blackboard teaching or the PowerPoint-based teaching. So now there are a lot of people who are moving into digital learning platforms. Now the issue is that we need to
We have an audio break. Samir, can you hear us?
I think he left the meeting.
He's dropped. Okay. So Samir has been dropped. So he'll dial back and I'm sorry, he'll get back shortly. Priya, are you back with us? Not yet, it looks like. So over to you, Vijay, for your responses.
Satish, there's a question from Jason Sabu. And the question goes, is there a possibility that US or other Western startups will consider increased hiring of full-time remote positions in other countries, including India? That's an interesting question. And I think the answer is yes. And I think the answer is that we're likely to see that happening in a more increased measure. It's already something that that we are witnessing. I do know of people who are directly working with companies overseas as individuals. But the interesting thing really would be, what does it take in order to be able to kind of land yourself into something nice and suitable? This is just like a company. So our company, for example, one, we'll have to make sure that we have good skills. Second, we'll have to make sure that we have seen and that we have heard and that we communicate very well with regard to what our skill sets are, so that we become a good prospective candidate for somebody who's looking to give work. So if as an individual or a freelancer, things are no different. There is likewise the need to ensure that there is a building of skills, that you do projects, that these skills that you have built are showcased, push code to GitLab, participate in a lot of very popular global competitions, which will really give you a lot of visibility. A couple of them are Kaggle and HackerRank. Kaggle, for those of you who are probably not aware, I think most of you would know, it's a subsidiary of Google. It's an online community of data scientists, and it runs hundreds of machine learning competitions. If you're looking at landing yourself a job remotely, perhaps HackerRank might be even more better. And that again is a company which focuses on competitive programming challenges. And their developers kind of compete to do programming, which is based on some given specifications. And there you're ranked. And if you have a good rank there, then the visibility obviously is extremely high, and the chances of landing yourself a good job on a remote basis is extremely high. One other point is to kind of do certifications, which again goes to kind of push your case very well. So the answer is certainly yes. There are a lot of opportunities that are there to do independent, freelance, remote-based work.
Thanks very much, Vijay. So I see that Samir is back. So Samir, please go ahead and complete your intervention.
Yeah. So my one point I want to make is that there is a lot of scope for focusing on the education sector, coming out with new products in the education sector, which can provide as a tool for faculty members, students, and administration to work with. Another point is just now I wanted to make a point, but that Vijay has already made a point that the students need to acquire a new certification and skill set in the coming months. Their courses will be over in another couple of months, and then they need to do an aggressive upskilling by means of the online platforms like HackerEarth or HackerRank and other kind of tools available, and as well as the new, courses in the new cutting edge areas. And in a matter of 3 to 6 months, they need to really upskill themselves to find a potential opportunity that may come up in the beginning of 2021. Where we hope that again a lot of hiring will happen because of the new project, new challenges that are coming up after COVID. Thanks.
Thanks, Samir. So with that, we come to the end of this session almost. There is just the vote of thanks left. And the overall situation seems to be that there is a lot of reason to be somewhat concerned. And there are certain things that we have to do from our side as professionals, as students, as industry members, and so on. But there is, as Dr. Gopinath said, light at the end of the tunnel. Things are going to go back. So this is exactly the time that we have to use to prepare ourselves for that phase of the growth that is coming in future.
Satish, can I add one thing?
Please go ahead.
It's actually not related to our discussion, but since we have a lot of faculty members as well as we have research students, just wanted to, I'm sure that many of us are working on COVID-related work, especially using the technology for us. So IIITMK has actually developed a search engine called vilogana.in. I'll type it out, which will help you on getting the peer-reviewed articles on anything related to the COVID. So if you type artificial intelligence in that, it'll give you what are the AI research which is happening in that, including the sentiment analysis and things like that. So if you're a researcher, this may be of use to you. I know that this is not our theme of today's discussion, but I thought that may be something which faculty members and others could be of use. Sorry for that.
Thanks very much, Dr. Upnath. It will be very useful in these times of a lot of fake news floating around. So it's good to have authenticated news. I'd like to request Fayaz, who's the convener of the strategic initiative on industry engagement of IEEE Kerala section, to propose a formal vote of thanks. Over to you, Fayaz.
Hello. I hope I'm audible to everyone.
Yes.
Good evening, you all. It's my privilege to have asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. And we had a very fascinating and engaging evening discussing the post-COVID changes in the technology job market. And we witnessed a very healthy panel discussion, which was worth for the time. And I am sure it's relevant for the sheer idea of rebuilding Kerala, as well as the whatever it is. And it's also because of the it was made possible because of the exquisite panel of experts in the respects we had here for the discussion. And first of all, I thank Mr. Afzal Sahalu, Chief Executive Officer, Bestock Technology Private Limited. Thank you for stressing on the thoughts of being proactive and acquiring new skill sets, which will be required by the industry. Your views on necessity of generating revenue by the startups to maintain the cash flow and rethinking the business models and the plans were excellent. Our next panelist is Ms. Priya Balan. Unfortunately, she couldn't participate in the panel discussion very well. She is the head of head of the HR department, Thermop and Paul Trivandrum. Thank you, ma'am, for your insightful comments on the changes which is about to happen in the manufacturing industry post COVID-19. Your thoughts on looking on the other side of the capricious COVID-19 scenario as a new opportunity for change was very rejuvenating. The pointers on exceptions of the industry from a fresher, the pointers on the expectations of the industry from a fresher as an experienced HR was excellent. I think that the students who are part of this meeting will make use of that. And I thank Mr. Sajeev Gopinath, CEO of Kerala Startup Nation and Director, RippleITM Kerala, for your words and for accepting our invitation as one of the panelists in such a short notice. Thank you for your words on the way startups can evolve by embracing the change and opportunities. And thank you for your examples, your insights on the gig economy and the necessity of being ready for it was exquisite. As a professional working closely with the government officials, we hope you will do the necessary for the student community of Kerala. Next, I thank Dr. Samir Assam, Professor and HOD, NIT Calicut, and member Board of Governors, APGAKTU. And he is also Chair of Strategic Initiative on Academic Engagement at the Kerala section. Your points on industry readiness of the industry readiness of the fresh graduates is always a topic of debate, especially in this kind of worst situation. And you were instrumental in bringing about the changes to be made in the education sector and the mindset of the students, synchronous to the very rough road ahead for the fresh graduates. Our next panelist is Mr. Vijay Kumar, Chairman CIE Kerala and Chief Executive Officer INAP. And being in the helm of the market and probably working as a freelancer shed some light on the end of the tunnel. I hope the young people who join this chat will make it useful. And thank you, Mr. Vijay, for sharing your views. The next is I thank our moderator, Mr. Sadish Babu, Chairman of Apralo ICANN, for your excellent way of handling the whole discussion. A gentle pat on your back for your efforts. And we look forward to team with you for more exemplary initiatives like this panel discussion. The next is an essential bunch of people, the office bearers of IEEE Kerala Section Strategic Initiative of Industry Engagement. I thank Mr. Shahin Becker for his hard work and organizing this event. I thank Mr. Jayakrishnan MC for your support in organizing this event. I thank our chair, Ms. Sharda, for supporting us. I also extend my gratitude towards Mr. Gilesh MP, IEEE Kerala Section Secretary, and Mr. Nandan S, Student Activities Chair, and Mr. Thomas Abu, Young Professionals Chair. An essential part of every event is an exceptional and engaging audience, and I thank you, audience, on behalf of IEEE Kerala Section. I hope it was an excellent event, and the questions raised by the audience were addressed. And let's make use of these ideas for the future. And there is a lot of points raised, and we can make use of that. And thank you all once again. Thank you for the evening.
Thank you very much. This meeting is now closed.